Hello and good morning, students. My name is Fazle Abbas and I welcome you all to the e-learning program initiated by Shri Gyanmanjari Vidyapeeth for the students of Standard 9th, academic year 21-22. Well, I will be teaching you English literature for this academic year 21 and 22. I assume that you are all in high spirits of health and hygiene and enjoying a safe time during this pandemic situation. With this assumption, I start my discussion over here with you. In this year, we will be using two texts to learn the subject of English literature. That is the NCERT text, Beehive, and Supplementary Reader, Moments. To discuss about the text, the Beehive contains altogether 11 units, of which the first 10 units contain two chapters each, a prose and a poem. And the 11th unit is a single chapter, that is a play, a drama. So out of these 11 units, we will be covering the first 6 units, that is 12 chapters from the Beehive, the main course book, the textbook in the first semester, and the remaining will be in the second semester. So let's take an overview of the content that we are going to cover in semester 1 from the textual book Beehive and from the supplementary reader Moments. As you can see, we will be looking into the first 6 units containing 2 chapters in each, a prose and a poem. The Fun They Had, written by Isaac Asimov. Sound of Music, which has got 2 parts in it, about Evelyn Glennon and Bismillah Khan, by Deborah Cowley. The third one is The Little Girl, yet another prose, by Catherine Mansfield. The fourth is a biography about Albert Einstein, A Truly Beautiful Mind. The fifth one is The Snake and the Mirror, a story by Wycombe Muhammad Bashir. The sixth one is My Childhood, about our former and late president APJ Abdul Kalam, whose full name was Abul Pakir Jainul Abedin Abdul Kalam. The next we have poems from Beehive, 6 poems that we are going to cover in Sem 1. The first one, which you already learned last year in Standard 8, The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Second is Wind, written by Subramanya Bharati. Third one is Rain on the Roof by Coates Kinney. The fourth one, The Lake Isle of Innisfree, written by William Butler Yeats. The fifth one is A Legend of the Northland by Phoebe Carey. Be very careful in pronouncing these names. They may be quite tricky for you to pronounce, so follow the accent correctly as I try to teach you. A Legend of the Northland by Phoebe Carey. Acknowledge that P and H sound as F, so it will be pronounced as Phoebe Carey. The sixth and the final poem that we are going to cover in Sem 1 is No Men Are Foreign by James Kirkup. So it's K-I-R-K-U-P, Kirkup. In addition to Beehive, we have a supplementary reader from which we will be taking up and understanding 5 chapters. The Lost Child, quite a famous and a popular piece of reading by Mulk Raj Anand. The Adventures of Toto by Ruskin Bond. By the name you may be feeling that it's an English writer, but Ruskin Bond is an Indian writer of an Indian origin. Third one is Iswaran, the Storyteller by R.K. Laxman. Fourth one is The Kingdom of Fools. It is about the Kannada folk tales, which has been translated by A.K. Ramanujan. The fifth one, The Happy Prince by Oscar Wilde. So these are the chapters that we will be covering in our studies for the SEM 1, which is a blend or a mixture of different genres. I hope you understand what is a genre. A variety of types of English literature is called a genre. We have stories, we have biography, we have poems, we have lyric. Therefore, we have a variety of genres written by Indian writers, American writers, so on. To discuss the first chapter given to us in the first unit, that is The Fun They Had, written by Isaac Asimov. This is a story written by Isaac Asimov. So even before we read the piece of writing written by him, it's important to know the writer. So have a look at your screen, the image being displayed with the relevant information about Isaac Asimov. I will discuss with you who he was and the other necessary information regarding the writer. So Isaac Asimov was born on 2nd January 1920
and died on April 6th, 1992.
He was an American writer and professor of biochemistry at Boston University. He was known for his works of science fiction. Well, in concise, you can say sci-fi. He was known for his sci-fi works and popular science. Asimov was a prolific writer, a great writer. He wrote a variety of things. Wrote and edited more than 5,000 books. He also wrote an estimated 90,000 letters and postcards. You see, letter writing or writing was a very integral part of writing in this given point of time when technology was not available. People used to communicate by the means of letters and postcards. Maybe in today's era, the practice of writing letters or perhaps writing postcard has completely elapsed.
The next image gives us information about the occupation, nationality, education and genre of Isaac Asimov. So let's go through it. He was a writer and a professor of biochemistry. If we understand about his nationality, he was a Russian, then Soviet in the early years, and later on he became an American since 1928. About his education, Columbia University, he educated himself as a Bachelor of Science in the year 1939. He did his Master of Arts in 1941 and Doctor of Philosophy in 1948. He was a sci-fi writer, science fiction writer. So the genre gives information about the kind of work, the kind of writing work he did. Most of his works were related to science fiction, mystery, and popular science. Well, this image provides us some personal information about Isaac Asimov, about his family, his relatives, his signature, his scientific career, and his children. The current image gives information about the thesis that he has written, The Kinetics of Reaction Inactivation of Tyrosinase During Its Catalysis of the Aerobic Oxidation of Catechol. In the year 1948, he wrote this thesis. Doctoral advisor was Charles Reginald Dawson. Other academic advisors were Robert Elderfield, postdoctoral. So these were the people who advised him, they were his advisors. Further information has been given about Asimov's writing. Asimov wrote hard science fiction along with Robert A. Heinlein and Arthur C. Clarke. Asimov was considered one of the big three science fiction writers during his lifetime. Asimov's most famous work is the Foundation series, the first three books of which won the one-time Hugo Award for Best All-Time Series in 1966. His other major series are Galactic Empire series and the Robot series. The Galactic Empire novels are set in the much early history of the same. Fictional universe as the Foundation series. Later with Foundation and Earth, 1986, he linked this distant future to the Robot series, creating a unified future history for his stories, much like those pioneered by Robert A. Heinlein and previously produced by Cord Wainer Smith and Paul Anderson. He also wrote over 380 short stories, including the social science fiction novelette Nightfall, which in 1964 was voted the best short science fiction story of all time by Science Fiction Writers of America. Asimov wrote the Lucky Star series of juvenile science fiction novels using the pen name Paul French. Well, Asimov also wrote mysteries and fantasies, as well as much non-fiction. Most of his popular science books explain concepts in a historical way, going as far back as possible to a time when the science in question was at its simplest stage. The examples have been given: the Guide to Science, the three-volume set Understanding Physics, and Asimov's Chronology of Science and Discovery. He wrote on numerous other scientific and non-scientific topics such as chemistry, astronomy, mathematics, history, biblical exegesis, and literary criticism. He was president of the American Humanist Association, the Asteroid 5020, Asimov, a crater on the planet Mars, Brooklyn Elementary Chemist School, Honda's humanoid robot. Asimov and four literary awards are named in his honor. Well, now after knowing the writer, let us look into the text and the chapter given to us, the story given to us, written by Isaac Asimov, the fun they had. To introduce this, the story that we are going to read is set in the future time. We are going to understand something that is going to happen in the future. So, it's a futuristic action. When books and schools, as we now know, so we are known to books, we know what books are, isn't it? Will perhaps not exist. So what is being told by the writer? What is the assumption made by the writer? Or what is he writing? He is saying that how will children study then? So he is trying to bring it to our notice. He is trying to make us, or he is trying to draw our attention. Because the way the technology is advancing at a giant pace, at a great pace, there may arrive a time that books may not be in use, just as you and I use books to read, to understand things. So, the story that we are going to read is set in the future when books and schools, as we now know them, will perhaps not exist. Then how will children learn? So that's the question Asimov has asked or brought to our notice. And about this, he has discussed in the following story. So let's go through the story lines given to us in paragraph wise as parts. Margie, yes, this is the character of the story. Margie even wrote about it that night in her diary on the page headed 17th May 2157. 2157. So, a matter to note over here. What is the writer saying? That Margie, a character, a girl in the story, she even wrote in it about this that night in her diary. So, she was a person who used to write her personal diary. Maybe you and I are not in the habit of writing personal diaries, but gradually, as time will advance, people will have a habit of writing. And
Even today, people have a habit of writing in diaries. But here, what is being told about? A digital diary. Although it's not mentioned digital diary, but she wrote it in her diary. We can assume that. What did she write? The exact words that she wrote was, "Today, Tommy found a real book." See, the sentence is quite surprising, isn't it? A shocking sentence. "Today, Tommy found a real book." What does that real book mean over here? Are they using fake books? No. She means to say that they have put their hands on a physical copy of a book. So we can assume that by 2157, around 130 plus years later, so more than a century to go, after a century or so, a century and 30 plus years, what would be the scenario? That books will have elapsed. We will not have any physical books to read and learn from. Just like we use the text today, isn't it? To read the content that you have in your hand. Maybe there will be students in future who would not require or who would not be having physical textbooks in their hand to read. They would be learning everything by means of technology. That would be the situation. Therefore, Margie has written in her diary on her page, headed, that is putting the heading or the date or dated 17th May 2157. "Today, Tommy found a real book." So it is a surprising sentence that she has written. Well, here builds up the entire story. It was a very old book. Margie's grandfather once said that when he was a little boy, his grandfather told him that there was a time when all stories were printed on paper. So, what is Margie recalling over here? She is trying to recall, along with this confirmation that the book that they have or what she had seen is a very old book. And just seeing this old book, she reconciles, she remembers what her grandfather said, that when he was a little boy, his grandfather, so Margie's great grandfather had told this thing. What did he told? That there was a time when all stories were printed on paper. Stories were printed on paper. Simple paper. Now the book that they have got has a particular physical appearance, which is being discussed in the next passage over here. They turned the pages. So when they had the book in their hand, they were curious to know how the book looked like. What was the content of the book? Because they are the children of the future time, the era of technology. So they turned the pages, which were yellow and crinkly. So I hope you understand, a very old book, even if you have an old book, say right now in your house, which will be around 50 years old or so, in your library or somewhere, and if you happen to see that book, their pages would have turned yellow due to the oxidization or due to the atmospheric reactions on the paper, the chemicals that are used in the process of making the paper. Therefore, pages turn yellow with the passage of time. And not only that, but they become so stiff that when you don't turn them very carefully, with great caution, they may happen to crink and break even. So it's called crinkly. They happen to break open, or they just come out as a bit and break apart. Therefore, the pages that they were turning were yellow and crinkly, and it was awfully funny. Well, for someone who has never ever seen a book in their entire life, it would be definitely fun to see something happening for the first time, isn't it? When we see something happening for the first time, it's enjoyable, exciting. We are curious to know more about it. So here, the children were finding it very awful, funny to read words that stood still instead of moving the way they were supposed to. So here, Margie was in the habit of seeing the words moving around, isn't it? On a screen, as we use computers, as we use tablets, as we use the modern gadgets these days. If you compare this to the older way of learning and the books, what happens? The things that are printed in a book, the words stay in its place, they don't move here and there. But unlike that, in a computer, we can move the words, we can scroll the entire page, isn't it? As you scroll the page, the words will shift, they will move upside and they will move downside.
So they were in a habit of seeing such kind of a way to acknowledge themselves, to read from. So when they saw this book, they found it very funny and awful to read and see that the words were standing in their place still and not moving here and there, unlike what they used to do on a screen, you know. And then when they turned back to the page before, it had the same words on it that it had when they read it for the first time. So that is what was finding very curious to Margie. Margie was finding it very curious, very, very awful and funny that the words were not moving and going here and there, or they were not moving as they were turning the pages, because they had seen this for the first time in their entire life. They were habitual to the computer screens. They were habitual to words disappearing and coming back. So this was their routine, the general practice of their dealing with words or dealing with stories or something that is in a written format, in an electronic format. "Gee," said Tommy, "what a waste." So a sound made by Tommy over here. He is using an onomatopoeic sound over here. We came across onomatopoeic words, isn't it? Last year in Standard 8. "Gee." So he is just making a sound over here and saying, "What a waste." So he is finding this a complete waste. When you are through with the book, you just throw it away, I guess. So here Tommy is making a guess over here that if you have finished reading a book, when the content inside the book has been read by you, you finish that, what will you do? Actually, you will just keep it away for years and years. You can't make any more use of it. Only if you have lent it to someone and someone is reading it. But if you have the book with you in your library almirah or somewhere, it will remain over there for years and years. And at the most, if you find it very troublesome, you will dispose it in a garbage or give it away to a bookseller or even to someone who is collecting book garbage or something, isn't it? So it's a complete waste in the point of view of Tommy. That is what he said. "He," said Tommy, "what a waste. When you are through with the book, when you're done with the book, when you don't need the book anymore, what happens? You just throw it away. I guess that's the guess he's making. And that is what happens. We know about it. When we have got no use of a book, simply we dump it or give it away. Further, he says, "Our television screen must have had a million books on it, and it's good for plenty more." So what is he saying? That our screen, what he is talking about, the computer that he has with him, our television screen or the computer screen that he is talking about, must have had a million books, because they are now used to learn things and read books on a big large screen. And we have large TVs too, isn't it? Big size TVs or big size screens. So he's saying our television screen must have had a million books on it. So our television screen is containing not one or two books, which is difficult to store or something. It has got millions of books on it, and it's good for plenty more. And not only that much, it is even capable of holding even more books. Despite of having million books in it already, still it has a capacity to store many, many more books. I wouldn't throw it away. Actually, he's not going to throw away the books. It's all in a digital format over there. It's easy to store, easy to retrieve, easy to read from, easy to scroll anywhere you like in the entire content in the book. So he's saying, I wouldn't throw it away. Just like he's assuming and guessing that after finishing with the book, after going through the book and having had all the necessary things for the book, people must be throwing it away. That is what he guesses. "Same with mine," says Margie. So you see, we've got two characters over here now. Margie, a girl, and Tommy, a boy over here. Well, assume both are friends. "She was 11 and hadn't seen as many telebooks as Tommy had. He was 13. So now the age is being told to us. That Margie and Tommy were 11 and 13 respectively, of their ages. You see, they are such small children, and they've never seen a book, a physical copy of a book, in their entire 11, 13 years of life. They've never seen so. Same with mine, says Margie, and further she's saying she was 11 and hadn't seen many telebooks as Tommy had. So Tommy being older to Margie, he has seen many telebooks and he has heard from his grandfather as well. She said, where did you find it? So Margie is asking a question to Tommy that actually where did you get this book from? So she's curious to know in this technology age, in this era of technology, what they were living, what they were experiencing. How come you got this book and where did you get it from? To answer this question, Tommy saying, in my house. So Tommy's house was containing these books, but he never knew about it. So in my house, he pointed without looking because he was busy reading. Tommy was busy reading and while he was reading, he was answering Margie's question. In my house, he pointed without looking because he was busy reading. And further, what is he saying? In the attic. So what is attic? Let me give you an understanding of attic. Attic is, say, a kind of a storage place, a small storage place, probably that is built under a staircase. Well, if you have a staircase in your house, well, that leads to the to a floor. Sometimes people have staircase, and underneath the staircase, there is some space left. So people create some storage space over here to store unwanted things or something that is of no use. So such a storage place is probably called a attic or a kind of a cupboards or sort of thing that is created in some extra space that you find in your house, probably under a staircase. So attic is a storage space or a kind of an almirah. So Tommy is saying that I found it in my house, being very busy, he says, in the attic. Another question comes to Margie's mind and he's asking Tommy, what's it about? Well, one word he's answering and saying school. So it's very surprising for Margie to hear this word school. But yes, that is what Tommy said on answering the question, what's it about? That was the question Margie had asked. So she wanted to know that if he has a book, the book must be having some kind of a topic, isn't it? Some title over it. What's the book all about? He says school. The only word he says is school. Well, Margie was scornful, completely bewildered, shocked to hear that the book was about school. How could a book be about school? School? What's there to write about school? I hate school. So Margie did not like school, just like maybe some of you don't like school, isn't it? So Margie was also, after all, a child. She did not like school. So Margie was very scornful and saying school, she asked the question that what was there to write about school? What was so important to write about school? How could one write about school? Margie always hated school, but now she hated it more than ever. So the mechanical teacher had been giving her test after test in geography and she had been doing worse and worse until her mother had shaken her head sorrowfully and sent for the county inspector. So well, Margie had her own reason for hating school, just like you people have, or some of you people have, or generally speaking children have a hatred for going to school because you have to wake up early in the morning, dress up yourself, board a commuting vehicle and arrive in school when you actually want to sleep, isn't it? So it happens, but still we have to come to school because it's important for our all-round development, isn't it? For the enhancement of our knowledge. So here also Margie, who was a future child, 2157, Margie always hated school, but now she hated it more than ever. Well, what's the reason? Generally she hated and now she's hating it more than ever. So it's mentioned over here. The mechanical teacher. So see, we're not talking about a human teacher. Talk about a mechanical teacher, probably a robot, who was teaching her. We'll have more information as we read through the chapter. The mechanical teacher had been giving her test after test in geography and she had been doing worse and worse. So the mechanical teacher was taking test upon test for Margie, which she was not liking. Actually, when there's a test, most of us don't like tests, isn't it? We have a disliking towards tests because if we are not fully prepared, or something is very difficult to learn, we don't perform well, and hence test is something that we don't like. So here the mechanical teacher had been giving her test after test in geography subject, and she had been doing worse and worse. So she was not able to perform. Despite of that, the mechanical teacher was conducting tests for her, until her mother had shaken her head sorrowfully. Now mother shook her head sorrowfully with great grief and sent for the county inspector, because she was very sad to see poor performance of her daughter Margie's performance. So Margie's mother finally sent for the county inspector. Now what's a county inspector over here? We need to understand this. Well, county inspector is someone, a human, who has programmed the mechanical teacher or the robot, isn't it? So they were learning with the means of robots or mechanical teachers. Humans were not teaching the Margie or Tommy over here. So the mother called for the county inspector. Maybe she noticed or she realized there was some kind of a defect, or there was some kind of a problem with the mechanical tutor or the mechanical teacher. So she called for the county inspector, the person who had designed that or who knew about the machine. Well, he was a round little man with a red face and a whole box of tools with dials and wires. So here the man arrived, the county inspector arrived. So the description has been given how he looked like. He was a round little man, so he was round, so round in shape, with red face and a whole box of tools with dials and wires. Naturally, a technician would be having all his required tools when he comes to visit or repair something or service something. So here he had come for to attend a complaint that was made by Margie's mother regarding the mechanical teacher or the robot that was assisting or teaching Margie. She found that there was some kind of a technical issue or error going on. That is why Margie was, or the mechanical instructor was, taking test after test. Well, to fix this up, the county inspector had arrived. The description has been given to us with all his tools, dials and wires. Well, he smiled at Margie and gave her an apple. So the man who had arrived over here offered an apple to Margie, then took the teacher apart. So what is the human being, that is the county inspector, doing? Took the teacher apart. Here the teacher is not some person over here. Here the teacher is meant by the machine or the mechanical teacher. So he took the teacher apart, away from Margie and her mother, to see what's the problem inside it. Margie had hoped he wouldn't know how to put it together again. So Margie was hoping, she was having this feeling in her heart, just like sometimes you have feeling in the heart, isn't it? When you come to school and you have a test, maybe you have a feeling that the test is postponed, it's cancelled. Maybe the teacher is absent for some reason today, and fortunately you get a good time, you don't have. Similarly, Margie also had this feeling in her heart that the technician has come to repair, to service, to fix up the problem that the mechanical teacher had, the robot had in it. But she was expecting, she was wishing that he wouldn't know how to put it together again. So that is what Margie was wishing in her heart, that hopefully the technician is unable to fix it up, and maybe he has to take it away for a year, take it to the service station for some time. But he knew how all right. But he knew how all right. And after an hour or so, there it was again, large and black and ugly, with a big screen on which all the lessons were shown and the questions were asked. But only an hour had passed now. Not much time had passed. And things were fixed. The black screen, the robot was all ready to work with Margie. The mechanical teacher was all set again. It was fixed up by the technician. He will be a very good technician. He knew all about it, how to fix it up. So that wasn't so bad. The part Margie hated most was the slot where she had to put homework and test papers. Well, that's true for even today's time, isn't it? When you come to school, the most dreadful part, or the most hated part, is the homework part, and probably the test part, isn't it? Well, so a similar situation even in 2057 students are facing. that you are experiencing today. So we can say students of this era and maybe 100 years or 100 plus years would be the same, but they would be using technology. That wasn't so bad. The part Margie hated most was the slot where she had to put the homework and the test papers. Well, moving ahead, we have, she always had to write them out in a punch code. They made her learn when she was 6 years old. So see, at the age of six, she had prepared herself. She had learned the punch code language. So what have we learned? We learned the alphabets, isn't it? The letters we learned in the lower classes when you were 6 years old, 5 years and 6 years old. In order to learn a language, whether it's Hindi, Gujarati, English, the letters were taught to you first. So the letters were learned by you so that you were able to utilize the language for communication, for writing purpose, for doing your homework, for reading things, isn't it? Similarly, it's the era of technology. So what was taught to her? She was taught punch code language. So a digital form of filling in the homework. So the punch code, they made her learn when she was just 6 years old, and the mechanical teacher calculated the marks in no time. Well, it takes time for a teacher to check papers, isn't it? She has to manually, physically check each and every person's answers, find out grammatical mistakes, judge the answer, jot down the marks for each and every question, and then finally total the entire set of numbers and give you the final result. Here, the mechanical teacher takes no time. The moment she gives the test, and within a few seconds, or within a minute or so, assuming that within a minute or so, the mechanical teacher can calculate the marks and generate the results. Well, that's the plus point we can say. The inspector had smiled after he was finished and patted Margie's head. So the inspector knew that the child was in a way not willing to learn. Upon the facial expressions, maybe he must have found out. So what did the inspector do? He gave a smile to Margie. And he patted, I hope you understand what's patted, just to touch someone's back or touch someone's head in order to just give a kind of an emotional feeling, a touch of expressing a kind of emotion to someone. Well, everything is good now, very well done. So he said to her mother, it's not the little girl's fault. So the county inspector had realized that it was not the fault of the girl why she was not able to perform. She was consistently poorly performing and getting worse to worst. So he said, it's not the little girl's fault, Mrs. Jones. Well, that's the name of Margie's mother, Mrs. Jones. So we have a name now over here, who Margie's mother is. I think the geography sector was geared a little too quick. So see, there was some technical issue. The tutor, the mechanical tutor, had some kind of a glitch inside it, a technical issue inside it. And therefore, he was teaching lesson after lesson. He was teaching the geography sector, the geography portion that was fed inside it. Because it's a machine, naturally. So data would be fed into it. And he will be teaching the data as per the programized or the programmed thing that would be working within it. So it was making some kind of error over here. So what did the county say? The county inspector said, I think the geography sector was geared a little too quick. So the time schedule that was fed inside it, the things that were done inside it, was programmed to teach a little quickly. Those things happen sometimes. I've slowed it up to an average 10-year level. So what did the county do? He reprogrammed or fixed the issue that was happening or that was being produced by the error that was produced by or the fast or the speedy work that was being delivered by the robot or the mechanical teacher. So he said that I have rescheduled or I have programmed that to an average 10-year level. So you see, that particular tutor, the personal tutor, the mechanical tutor that was teaching Margie was now programmed by the technician who had come over here, the county inspector, for that particular mindset, that is a 10-year old level. Well, it's a mechanical teacher. Whatever data has been fed and how it is to be delivered, that will be done by it. But there was a technical issue. He was delivering the things even more speedier Then the reception level of that child, that's a 10-year-old Margie. She was 11 years. Actually, the overall pattern of her progress is quite satisfactory. To give a kind of satisfaction to Mrs. Jones, the county inspector further added and said, actually the overall pattern of her progress is quite satisfactory. There's nothing to worry about it. So, due to the mechanical teacher's fault, the problem that arrived in the software or into the program, that is the reason why it was generating test after test and he was going so fast. And he patted Margie's head again. So once again he patted Margie's head and probably he must have left. Well, Margie was disappointed. Naturally Margie was disappointed. Now, why was she disappointed? Let us see. She had been hoping they would take the teacher away altogether. See, what was Margie expecting? As I just said earlier, they would be hoping that the technician would have to carry the teacher, that is the mechanical teacher, the robot, the machine, to the service station to get the problem fixed. That was in the mind of Margie going on. Therefore, it did not happen that way. Hence, Margie was very, very disappointed because what her expectation was did not meet up. They did not take away the mechanical teacher, perhaps it was fixed within her house. They had once taken Tommy's teacher away. So see, why is she saying so? On what pretext is she assuming this? There would naturally be some under some pretext that she would be assuming that why this would happen to her, or it could happen to her. Because she had seen once that they had once taken Tommy's teacher away for nearly a month because the history sector had blanked out completely. So you see, this could happen with a machine, isn't it? There could be an erroneous situation, a major fault inside it, and you may have to take away the machine for its repairing works, for its reprogramming work, or any kind of technical issues that may have occurred because it's an electronic thing. So Margie was expecting a similar issue in her personal tutor, in the mechanical teacher that she had in her house. You see, she was expecting, just like Tommy's teacher was taken away for a month, maybe my teacher will also be taken away for a month, and for 1 month I will not have to study, isn't it? So she was happy to assume this. But unfortunately her hopes had shattered away. It got repaired and serviced and reprogrammed by the county inspector then and there. It was fixed easily by the person. So she said to Tommy, why would anyone write about school? So she said to Tommy, why would anyone write about school? Another question she popped into Tommy's mind and said that why would anyone write about school? She wanted to know. Well, for today, we will conclude our discussion over here. So far we've just introduced the chapter to ourselves, finding out that how Margie and Tommy are having a conversation. They are two children, 11 years and 13 years of age. They are using mechanical teachers and not human teachers. They are not being taught by human teachers, just like I am teaching you today and you learn in schools, isn't it? The general way when we learn in today's era, that is, a number of students come to school in a particular building, they sit in a classroom, in a bench, they learn a common thing from the teacher, the teacher tries to interact with them. So such things don't happen with them, isn't it? Well, we've introduced the chapter and understood about the first part of it up to point number 5 or stanza number 5. In the upcoming lecture, we will continue our discussion from stanza number 6. After a recapitulation, hope you understood this very well. See you soon again. Till then, take care. Have a nice day.